for all your show nights. This is how we feel. You're listening to Sound Opinions, and next up we're going to have a discussion with the man who authored that song, Rivers Cuomo of Weezer. That is My Name is Jonas, from Weezer's 1994 debut album that sold millions of copies at the height of the grunge era. He had bands like Nirvana and Soundgarden, Pearl Jam, dominating the charts from the Pacific Northwest with this harder, heavier sound. And then along comes this California band led by Rivers Cuomo with this anthemic pop sound that sold millions of records and captivated the MTV generation with these witty videos that accompanied those songs. Rivers Cuomo has gone on to have a career that extends to this very day. Weezer's still putting out albums. Their latest came out in 2009 called Ratitude. In between, Cuomo has released several solo projects that have documented his home recordings. One of the most prolific and well-known artists working today.
Yeah, Greg, you know, we were lucky to have Rivers in late 2009, just a couple of days before he had a bus accident while traveling with the band, suffered a couple of cracked ribs, and Weezer had to cancel several weeks worth of tour dates. Now the band's back on the road. Rivers is mended. When he was here, he was not playing with Weezer, however, but a Chicago group called the Cathy Santonies. You're listening to Sound Opinions, and Greg, I think in all the years of doing this show, this is the one of the most unique tapings we've ever done.
It is the most unique taping we've ever done.
We have Rivers Cuomo of Weezer here, and Rivers said, okay, I'm going to do it. Here's the deal, though. You're going to pair me up with a band of your choosing, and you're going to tell me which songs you'd like me to play.
I feel like Phil Spector today.
I do. We feel like producers.
Yeah.
So first of all, Rivers, welcome.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
And we have a wonderful band who you met all of about 20 minutes ago. They're the Cathy Santonies, who are Mojo Santoni on guitar and Jane Danger on guitar and Radio Santoni on bass and Kaylee Preston, who has got a fever and a horrible cold, and she's here smashing away at the drums anyway. Welcome, Cathy Santonies.
Thank you.
So, Rivers, what the heck are you doing here? What was this idea about?
Well, I don't know. I just love to mix it up and try different things and play with different musicians from different backgrounds and put myself in uncomfortable situations and and see what happens, live on the edge. And we did it last year with Weezer. We'd invite 100 to 200 Weezer fans down to the show, and they brought their instruments, whatever instruments they happen to have, and we had to make music with these people, and it was super invigorating for me. And then writing songs for Ratitude, I continued that spirit of collaboration and reached out to other musicians and songwriters and jammed with them and came up with some of the songs for the record. So I thought it would be fun to not only play with some musicians here I'd never met before, the Santonies, but also to involve you guys as producers and masterminds.
Masterminds, I love that word. I've never been called a mastermind before. Thank you, Rivers, I appreciate that.
That's the first time anyone's put that word next to our names,
Exactly. You've talked recently about this whole idea that there has been a transformation in your approach to this sort of thing. A few years ago, you were talking about just being ultra-shy and the shoegazer approach when you were on stage. In other words, it wasn't really a fun thing, it seemed like, for you to be there. And it seems like it's changed a lot for you in the last 3 or 4 years. What accounts for that?
I don't know. I think just looking for kicks, and the more I come out of my shell and the more I try different things, the more fun I have. So it encourages me to keep trying. And not only that, but we've gotten good feedback from the crowd, like, whoa, that was the best Weezer show I ever saw. So I'm having fun, and it's slowly all coming out of me now, and I can't wait to see where it's going.
Well, we have the band here set up to play, the Cathy Santonies, and we have Rivers here. You are not playing guitar. You're simply singing the lead vocals. The rest of the band is going to play their parts. To clarify for the listeners, the Santonies practiced, rehearsed on their own, and got ready for this gig. You literally heard them play for the first time 20 minutes ago.
Yeah, we did a sound check.
And we're going to sort of work our way through the songs that we've selected for you. So why don't we set up what we're going to play first here? I believe we have the Undone, the Sweater song, racked up first, right?
That's right. This is actually the first song I wrote that ended up getting played by Weezer. It's essentially the first Weezer song ever written.
Oh, so the ideal place to start.
Yeah.
Everybody's got a big smile on their face. That's Rivers Cuomo playing for the first time half an hour after meeting them with the Cathy Santonies. That's pretty good. So is this working for you, Rivers, this weird idea that you had?
That was super fun.
That sounded like fun.
That seems closer in the origins. You've talked about referencing Metallica a little bit in that song, and that seemed a little closer to those Metallica origins.
Yeah. I didn't know it at the time. I was trying to write a Velvet Underground cool hipster type of song. I was transitioning out of being a metalhead, suddenly realized that I was not cool and trying to be cool. And then years later, I realized it was basically the riff to Sanitarium from Master of Puppets by Metallica.
Well, one of the things that made me think that the Santonies would work was that they described themselves as the ideal combination of Riot Girl and, you know, metal testosterone rock as filtered through, like, the Runaways or Joan Jett. So I figured you would relate.
I was feeling the testosterone.
Right, right. These girls have got more testosterone than I do, I'll tell you that. We're going to take you through your career kind of chronologically, Rivers. You know, that album was such a breath of fresh air, self-titled Weezer album, the Blue Album, as fans now call it, when it came on the scene in 94. Was it a reaction to what had come before? I mean, it was so not grunge Seattle, what was coming out of there.
Yeah, I've just always had the personality that if I see a crowd of people doing one thing, I want to do the opposite thing. Mm. And at that time in L.A., 92... you know, everyone was jumping on the grunge bandwagon and getting dreadlocks and tattoos and nose rings and writing like these bluesy grunge riffs. And it just made me want to run in the opposite direction. Got a clean cut hairdo and nice button down shirt and major key and nice melodies and songs about girls.
How much of it was inspired by? I mean, I looked at that first cover before I ever played the Blue Album and I said, wow, you know, Modern Lovers, Talking Heads, circa 77, the Feelies.
Yeah, Feelies.
You know, even that blue sky background. We are who we are. We're nerds, and we're proud of it.
Yeah. Interesting, though. I wasn't aware of any of those album covers. Mm. People started mentioning them to me after the album came out, but I wasn't influenced by them. There was a particular picture of the Beach Boys that I was totally inspired by, where they're wearing these matching striped shirts, and they're all just sitting there really nicely together in front of a blue background. And I just thought that was so cool and anti-everything and We had to do it.
And I think people read a lot into the image and also the videos, which were incredibly entertaining, hilarious. They assumed it was, a lot of this music was sort of tongue-in-cheek. Did that bother you that the music may have been misinterpreted? Did people miss the message in some ways because they thought it was being ironic and humorous?
Yeah, that's something Weezer has had to deal with from the first album right up to our current album, Ratitude, is that I will write something from a sincere place. I'm trying to make a serious statement. And then everyone in the room starts laughing and say, oh, he's being ironic. This is so funny. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I remember we'd finished the Blue album, and I felt like it was the most amazing album. We were going to be taken very seriously, like the next Nirvana or something. And the guy from the record company took me out to lunch and said, you realize that people are going to think this album is really funny and you guys are like this lighthearted, jokey type of band. And I was completely stunned and disappointed. Mm. And he was right. That's how a lot of people took it. And so I'm still grappling with that, trying to understand what's going on here, because there does seem to be this ironic element to Weezer's music. I can't deny it. But at the same time, I'm trying to be serious, and there is a serious point underneath it all. So I don't know what to make of it.
Goddamn you, half Japanese girls. Do it to me every time. All the redheads said to shred the cello, and I'm jello, baby. But you won't talk, won't look, won't think of me. I'm the epitome, a public enemy. Why you wanna go and do me like that? Come down on the street and dance with me. I'm a lot like you, so please. Hello, I'm here, I'm waiting. I think I'd be good for you, and you'd be good for me. You said you never heard of them. How cool is that? So I went to your room, read your diary. Watching grunge leg drop New Jack to a press table. Then my heart stopped listening to Cho-Cho San. Falling in love all over again. I'm a lot like you, so please. Hello, I'm here, I'm waiting. Oh, we're crazy now. I think I'd be good for you. Make a record of my heart.
Come up to me and say hello.
How stupid, for all I know you want me to. And maybe you just don't know what to do. Maybe you're scared to say I'm falling for you. I wish I could get my head out of the sand, cause I think we make a good team. You could keep my fingernails clean, but that's just a stupid dream that I won't realize, cause I can't even look in your eyes without shaking. And I ain't thinking of bringing home the turkey if you bring home the bacon. I'm a lot like you, so please. Hello, I'm here, I'm waiting. I think I'd be good for you, and you'd be good for me.
Out on the floor, shaking booty, making sweet love all the night. It's time I got back.
cool. I'm a pig, I'm a dog. So excuse me if I drool. I ain't gonna hurt nobody, ain't gonna cause a scene. Just need to admit that I want sugar in my tea. Give it, I want sugar in my tea. And I don't wanna be an old man anymore. It's been a year or two since I was down on the floor. Taking booty, making sweet love all the night. It's time I got back to the good life.
That was The Good Life from Weezer's second album, The Pinkerton. Rivers Cuomo on lead vocals. The Cathy Santonies doing everything else. An unbelievable first take. That's when the producer goes, okay, yeah, I think we got something here.
Well, there's nothing ever like that first take. And we said, do you want to run through each of the songs first with the Cathy Santonies? And they did a sound check. They said, no, I think we ought to just start taping. Because there's a magic, right? The first time a song comes together.
Yeah, there definitely can be. Sometimes it's a train wreck and you have to do a second or third take, but a lot of times that first take is just magic.
Yeah, well, there it was. The Pinkerton album is an interesting period for you, Rivers, because it followed up this huge selling record that has gone on to sell well over 3 million copies, put you guys on the map. You talked about being misinterpreted somewhat on that first record in terms of the way people perceived the band. Pinkerton is regarded as somewhat of a more serious effort. In fact, I've heard some people talk about Rivers' Puccini period for this record. The references to Madame Butterfly, things like that. You were listening to a lot of classical music, I take it, bringing some of that in. What was your thinking going into making this record? Did you want to distance yourself a little bit from what happened and the way that first album was interpreted?
Absolutely. I mean, that's classic second album scenario. First album was real successful, but there's a lot of critics and, you know, the saying that Weezer's just a joke band, there's no serious message here. Mm-hmm. And I very consciously made an attempt to make a very serious album. I started listening to a lot of more critically accepted music or acclaimed music like Sebado and Flaming Lips. We got the Flaming Lips engineer to come and help us with Pinkerton. Lyrically, I wanted to stay away from anything that could be misinterpreted, and I just, you know, in very simple English, talked about what was going on in my life, in my mind, in my heart, and didn't try to use any crazy metaphors or sweaters or homies or Buddy Holly or anything, you know, just very straightforward and hoping that I could be understood that way.
Mm-hmm. And yet the album was not accepted at all.
No.
How disappointing was that to you?
Yeah, it's so disappointing and really humiliating because I felt like I was just clearly sharing inside of myself and telling my band members and my record company manager and everyone, say, just let me share this with the world, and I think this is going to be the right move for everyone. And the world said, you know, they just turned their backs on it.
So yeah, Weezer sucks now.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I think the shorthand history in people's heads is that the lack of acceptance for Pinkerton, you took some time off, you went to Harvard. Hardly a vacation. Was that a direct result? You know, I mean, I know that you wanted to further your education and you were eager to get back to academia, but was the lack of the world catching on to Pinkerton at first what drove you back?
Well, that's not exactly accurate, and I know that's the impression out there, but actually I went to Harvard before making Pinkerton. You know, I wanted to escape the craziness of the Blue Album touring cycle, and I wanted to go away and just study and work on music, and that's when I was writing Pinkerton. And then Pinkerton came out and didn't do so well, and I actually dropped out of school at that point. Mm. And all I wanted to do was come back and make another amazing rock record. I wasn't in school. I wasn't touring with the band. All I was doing was woodshedding and trying to figure out how to make a rock album again. And it took a long time.
So that's what that period of inactivity
those
was.
Those are the dark years.
Yeah. Well, okay. You know, during those dark years, though, a funny thing happened because I had an intern who was about 18, 19 years old at the time. This is like 98 or so, 99. And he was going on and on about this great band, Weezer. He thought Pinkerton was their first album. And he just thought it was the most amazing thing. And at the time, that word emo was going around, emotional punk rock. And in some ways, you became the godfathers of that movement all of a sudden, I'm sure, through no fault of your own.
Proto-emo.
But you were being adopted by all these teenagers and early 20s kids at that point. Were you aware of that sort of groundswell of underground support that Pinkerton was sort of getting 2-3 years after the fact?
Yeah, I remember it was in 1999, and I was living in my room, and I'd painted all my walls black and just totally by myself. And it was before I got rid of my phone, though. I still had a phone. My friend Kevin called me, and he had just been out on the road with his band, Ride El High. And he said, you know, there's this new movement called emo, and like these bands love Weezer, and they love Pinkerton especially. Mm. And there's like all these fans out there for you guys now. And I just thought, you're just trying to cheer me up, dude. Leave me alone. I got to go back to work here. But then, yeah, around 2000, we started getting offers for shows. And these were like big offers, and we started playing again. At that point, we realized, holy cow, this record does mean a lot to a lot of people out there.
I have to say, in Sound Opinion's history of, you listen to the show. At the end of the show, we get all those calls from people telling us where we're wrong about everything.
Yeah.
We have been getting more hate mail for both championing Ratitude, and I really love the Red album, the last self-titled Weezer album, and Greg and I were split, but I got so much crap for that. It seems to be that there's a certain segment devoted, hardcore, for whom Pinkerton has now, ironically, become sacred text. And anything else you do isn't Pinkerton. Therefore, we're mad at Rivers, and we hate you, and we hate everybody who likes Weezer these days.
Yeah, I don't know how to get out of that. It's a really destructive relationship. I don't know how to get out of it.
Well, you said you came back and you were surprised. You're playing to these bigger audiences. You know, the last decade has been, I think, where a lot of that comes from. I think there was this built-up appreciation for Pinkerton, like it was, ahead of its time in some ways. But by the time you came back to recording, it seemed like your head was in a different space in terms of the kind of music that you wanted to make and that you wanted to hear.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that's only natural. It's like 4.5 years later, and I changed fast, man. From album to album, I'm on to something new, and I am who I am.
Yeah, especially in those Home Alone records that you've put out where the liner notes are so fantastic. You talk a lot about the different kinds of music that you've listened to over the years. And I think one of the things that you've sort of come back to is that you want to be part of the conversation in pop music. You never really wanted to be an underground artist. I mean, that was never the goal, right?
Well, I'd say maybe on Pinkerton, I really wanted that underground acceptance.
Mm-hmm.
My goal on Pinkerton was to really be embraced by the cool people, for sure.
And that changed?
I still want to be embraced by the cool people,
yeah.
But I also want to be embraced by the uncool people and everyone else.
Uh-huh.
Being embraced.
Yeah. One of the only downsides, I think, of where Weezer is at today is that we've got to go to an Aragon ballroom or we've got to go to an Allstate Arena here in Chicago, these giant enormo domes. A lot of critics, these two included, said that certain songs like Hashpipe and Beverly Hills seem to be attempts to write for the arena.
I don't think I write thinking of the room so much. Beverly Hills, it's just like any other song. I picked up an acoustic guitar and I was really heartbroken over this thing that happened. Went to the opening of the new Hollywood Bowl, and there's a program there. I was looking through it. I saw this picture of Wilson Phillips, and they looked really pretty and kind of like established Hollywood celebrity. And I was thinking, man, I've been doing this for 8 years. I've been a rock star, and still I don't have, like any celebrity girlfriends. I'm just living in this one-room apartment by myself. What's going on, man? I want to be a star. And I just let it out in that song, Beverly Hills. And there's nothing calculated about it.
You say, though, that song is coming from a personal place, and I would say that is one of the big accusations that's leveled at you the last few years, is that you're writing for the marketplace. In fact, I said that on the previous record. I thought there's a little bit of pandering almost going on here. It's like you're trying to imagine.
I love that word.
Yeah.
Because a lot of critics were saying the same thing, but they didn't hit the nail on the head. And when you used the word pandering, I think that really crystallized the whole criticism. That's what people think I'm doing.
So how do you address that? You're saying you're not doing that. You're not imagining what the marketplace wants and giving it to them. It's coming from a different place.
No, I wouldn't go as far as to say that. I mean, I do think of my audience. I also think of, like, what am I trying to say here? And it's finding the language that I can communicate what's going on inside me to a wider audience.
So it's still coming from a personal place is what you're saying.
Yeah, it starts out from a personal place, and then I have to figure out how to communicate it to a wider audience. Sometimes I don't get it great. Sometimes it comes off like pandering.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's magic.
The thing that I would say switched it for me on Ratitude was that I did sense, you know, you were still writing these marketplace type songs, but at the same time it seemed to be coming from a more personal place, at least the way I interpreted the record. And part of that was the sense of melancholy that sort of underpinned some of those songs. Like there was almost a loss of innocence, and you were in the head of that teenage boy that you were when you were 16, 17.
I know it isn't right, but still I have to fight. I have to let you know, I don't want to let you go. The pain is killing me, but I can't let it be. I have to let you know.
Some critics said I was writing, thinking of teenagers or something, but I was thinking of myself as a teenager.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like I enjoy reminiscing, and it has a nostalgic feel to me. I don't feel like I'm pandering. Or with Heart Songs, this is a song you guys have asked me to play today, too. I'm just talking about the songs I listened to when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, see, one of the biggest fights outside of Bruce Springsteen that Greg and I have ever had is in the enduring merits of Heart Songs. Everyone who loves music has that moment when they were 9 or 10 and you hear some song on the radio, and for the first time it's not just background noise or something pleasant. It connects with you on an emotional level.
You know, I was just talking about the songs that were important to me. If I was writing for kids today, why would I mention Eddie Rabbit or Gordon Lightfoot?
You know? Yeah.
What could be less cool or dated? I mean, no offense to those artists. Obviously, I love them.
The idea that I had with the Santonies was to do a mashup, to do a medley. I thought, let's take a song from the very beginning of your career, again, the Blue Album, In the Garage, and put it together with Heart Songs. Because to me, they're flip sides of the same impulse. You fall in love with music when you're 10 or 11 sitting in the back of your folks' car hearing Eddie Rabbit, of all things. And then, you know, as soon as you can, you pick up a guitar and you go out to the garage, you make a god-awful but wonderful noise.
Mm.
Now we're going to put these two songs together and we're really going to challenge them. In the Garage from the debut album again, 94, and Heart Songs from the third self-titled Weezer album, a.k.a. the Red Album in 2008 on Sound Opinions.
I wasn't having any fun till my roommate said, come on and put a brand new record on. Had a baby on it, he was naked on it. Then I heard the chords broke, the chains I had upon me. I've got the sentimental sky, I've got bug sided dyes, I've got kitty pride and night color too. Wait, it's there for me, yes I do, I do. Got posters on the wall, my favorite rock group kids. I got Ace Frehley, I got Peter Criss waiting there for me. Yes, I do, I do. In the garage, I feel safe. No one cares about my ways. In the garage, where I belong. No one hears me sing this song. In the garage. Woo! I got an electric guitar, I play my stupid songs.
garage where I belong. No one hears me sing this song.
Pulled that off.
Yeah, I don't know. You want
to
do
it? That wasn't that bad. That was first time ever, a medley of In the Garage and Heart Songs on Sound Opinions with Rivers Cuomo on lead vocals and the Cathy Santonies bringing the rock. That brings us to the last song we wanted to have you play, Rivers. And actually, this is the first song when it was suggested that we suggest the set list.
We loved it when it appeared last year on Alone to the Home Recordings, and we love it anew on Ratitude.
Tell us about the genesis of Can't Stop Party.
Okay. I was a fan of Jermaine Dupri's We Belong Together, which is sung by Mariah Carey. I think somehow word got out to him, and he said he was a Weezer fan, and we just thought, let's get together and try something. So he just sent me this the first draft of the song Can't Stop Partying. We were in the middle of making the Red album, actually, when Weezer first heard the demo. It was a strange feeling, like, that is so cool, but it's so not us. And so for about a year, I just struggled with trying to rewrite it and change the lyrics so it wasn't just about, like, woohoo, hip-hop party, we're going to drink and smoke and everything's going to be awesome. Because that's not exactly who Weezer is. Everything I tried lyrically was just, it seemed to throw off the fun element of the song. So eventually I struck on the idea of making the music sad and put it in a minor key and making it kind of haunting and beautiful. And that would change the lyrics without even having to change a word. So that's how Can't Stop Partying became a Weezer song.
Mm-hmm. And it's fascinating, too, to hear the transition from the acoustic demo and then the version that Weezer put out, which has more of a dance beat to it. How did you feel about that disco beat? Was that your idea to sort of give it a little bit more emphasis in that direction?
Well, we have struggled mightily with this song. It's been a real creative problem for us to work on, in which, to me, those are the best kind of songs. That's where you really grow. We have Jermaine's first hip-hop version of it, and then we have my version on Alone 2, which is acoustic and very haunting. And then Weezer tried to do a rock version. Just wasn't as fun for some reason. So then we asked Polo Dedan to do his production for Ratitude. It's got all these spacey synthesizers in it and stuff, and that sounded amazing to us. And yet, Ratitude came out, and just 2 days ago, I was back in the studio working on a new version of the song with live drums and more electric guitar. So, you know, it's still a work in progress in my mind.
Well, and now we're going to hear it with the Cathy Santonies backing you up, which is a whole other...
the definitive version.
Well, who knows, you know? If this works out, you take them in the studio. And
so the burning question is, should I do the Lil Wayne rap or not?
I think the producers both say yes on that.
Unless you guys want to do it.
Yeah. No, we don't rap.
I can't stop.
partying, partying, I can't stop. Partying, partying, I gotta have control, I gotta have the beat, I gotta have a lot of pretty girls around me. Oh, I can't stop. Partying, partying, I can't stop. Partying, partying, I gotta have the cars, I gotta have the jewels. If you was me, honey, you would do it too. Monday is Sunday, I hit all the clubs. Nobody knows me when I'm pulled up. Not for real, babe, party with me, yeah, I'm deep. If you're looking for me, I'm a VIP. Swallowing and smoking and bringing bottles of the goose. And all the girls in the corner getting loose. Screwing cab, I love my addiction. No sleep, no sleep. I am always on a mission because I can't stop. Partying, partying, I can't stop. Partying, partying, I gotta have control. Gotta have the beat. Gotta have a lot of pretty girls around me. Oh, I can't stop. Partying, partying, I can't stop. Partying, partying, I gotta have the cars. I gotta have the jewels. If you was me, honey, you would do it too. Party like tomorrow is my funeral. Gotta stop, pitch another hell of pharmaceutical. And unusual, it's the freaking usual. Man, my life is beautiful, and my girls are mutual. Okay, bitches, Weezer and it's Weezy. I'm playing on TV. Please don't shoot me down because I'm an indigenous. Days of my life, but my night just started. Pray the killers and the things are right. I'm a party. I can't stop. Partying, partying, I can't stop. Partying, partying, I gotta have the car. Gotta have the shoes. And if you was me, honey, you would do it too. I can't stop. Partying, partying, I can't stop. Partying, partying, I gotta have the car. I gotta have the shoes. And if you was me, honey, you would do it too.
Can't Stop Partying by Rivers Cuomo and the Cathy Santonies. Mojo Radio, Kaylee Preston back there and Jane Danger. Thank you for working so hard. And I hope this was fun for you guys.
Thank you guys so much.
That worked for
Sounds
you, Rivers?
Awesome. Totally.
Not bad, huh, these guys?
That was super fun.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for coming on Sound Opinions and for being daring enough to really challenge yourself.
My pleasure.